We've got a general idea of what fiscal policy is, so let's take a look at the effects it can have on the supply side of the economy. Supply side economists believe that the effect of a change in taxes has a large effect on real GDP and employment. They believe that, at full employment, the real wage rate adjusts to make the quantity of labor demanded equal to the quantity of labor supplied. Additionally, at potential GDP, real GDP is at the full employment level. Supply-side economists believe that a tax on personal income changes potential GDP and aggregate supply. This results in a change of the full employment quantity of labor to a lower point of real GDP. Because people are being taxed more, their incentive to work decreases. This is shown as a leftward shift of the labor supply curve. The consequence of a reduction in supply is an increase in nominal wages. Because nominal wages have increased, firms hire fewer workers. Keep in mind, this does not imply a shift in the labor demand curve. It is simply a movement along the labor demand curve as a result of an increase in the equilibrium wage rate. The before-tax wage rate is at the new equilibrium, shown by the intersection of the labor supply plus tax curve and the labor demand curve. The after-tax wage rate is where the equilibrium quantity of labor intersects with the original labor supply curve. The difference between the before-tax wage rate and the after-tax wage rate is known as the tax wedge. This is shown on the graph as the vertical distance between the two labor supply curves. We've established that the full employment quantity of labor changes. If we go back to the production function that we discussed in a previous lecture, we see that this impacts potential GDP as well. Since the quantity of labor has decreased, the quantity of real GDP produced at full employment will also decrease, thus reducing potential GDP. Going back to the ADAS model, this is shown by a shift of the short-run aggregate supply curve and the long-run aggregate supply curve. We know that potential GDP has decreased due to a fall in the employment quantity of full employment quantity of labor. This is illustrated by a leftward shift of the long-run aggregate supply curve from LRAS to LRAS1. The money wage rate has also increased, and this is shown by a leftward shift of the short-run aggregate supply curve from SRAS to SRAS1. The end result is a lower quantity of real GDP and a higher price level. I also want to mention that taxes on consumption expenditure, also known as indirect taxes, increase the tax wedge, or the vertical distance between the two labor demand curves we saw earlier. This happens because the tax raises the prices paid for goods and services, which is just as good as a decrease in the real wage rate. Another form of income tax is one on interest income. Interest income is the income earned from investing in capital goods or other financial instruments. If I have a savings account at a bank, for example, I earn interest on the money I have deposited. A tax on interest income would mean that I have to pay tax on the interest I earn. A tax on interest income reduces the incentive to save. If I earn less money on the money that I have saved, why should I save it? The effects of a tax on interest income are more serious than those of a tax on personal income, because the quantity of savings is lowered, which increases the interest rate and lowers investment. Also, the tax on interest income is much higher because inflation already cuts a part of the interest income. The tax adds on to it, and we'll see why in this example. Let's say that the nominal interest rate is 10%, the rate of inflation is 6%, and the tax rate is 40%. We need to calculate the true tax rate. When taxes are collected, they are collected on nominal income and not real income. So we deduct the tax first. We multiply the nominal interest rate, which is 10%, by 0.4, which is the decimal form of the 40% tax rate. Our nominal tax rate as a total value, or in other words, in the same units as the nominal interest rate, is 40%. This is not 4% of the nominal interest rate, this is 40% of the nominal interest rate, which equals 4. We subtract this 4% from the nominal interest rate to get a 6% after-tax nominal interest rate. Now we have to account for inflation, which is 6%. 6% minus 6% equals zero, and thus we don't have any sort of real income from our savings, saving our money and earning interest on it. The true tax rate is thus 100% of the real interest earned. I mentioned that a rise in interest rates is one of the effects of a tax on interest income. We can see how this works by looking at the market for loanable funds. When interest income is taxed, the incentive to save money diminishes. After the tax is applied, the supply of loanable funds curve shifts to the left because people save less. This results in a new equilibrium at a higher interest rate. A tax wedge exists here as well, and it works the same way as it did with personal income tax. It is the vertical distance between the SLF and SLF plus tax curves. We know from previous lectures that when the interest rate increases, investment decreases. This happens because it is now more expensive to loan money from the bank. For someone who is still saving their money in the bank, however, despite the rise in the real interest rate, the after-tax interest rate falls. The after-tax interest rate is at the point where the new equilibrium quantity of loanable funds intersects the original supply curve of loanable funds. The Laffer curve is the proposition that a higher tax rate does not always mean a greater tax revenue. It shows the relationship between the tax rate and the amount of tax revenue collected by a government. The idea is that there is a tax rate that exists, after which if the government continues to increase the tax rate, it will lose tax revenue. This occurs because of what we saw earlier on the personal income taxes. As income taxes increase, people choose to work less and less. Despite wage increases, there is a certain point after which there are too few people working, so despite the really high tax rate, the overall money collected by the government actually decreases. France is an example of a country which is said to be very close, if not past, the maximum point on the Laffer curve. This would imply that if France were to decrease its tax rate, the government might actually increase its total tax revenue.